One of the symptoms of depression is guilt and regret. You might experience what we call survivor guilt. For instance, you were in a car accident and one of your family members died and you survived. Or, you know, most of your team members, they were retrenched and you were left. You are grieving the loss of your team, but also you are feeling guilty that they are having to suffer. And so you might find yourself in this state where you feel a lot of depressive symptoms. So there is intense sadness, which might show itself up as a crying spells, really intense feelings of loneliness. We have loss of appetite or eating too much. We have lack of motivation, concentration, and focus is not possible. Either you find yourself daydreaming a lot or going into a zone where you are not aware of your current, your present space, or changes in your sleep. Sometimes you are not able to sleep. You are afraid of the night coming, because that means if you go to sleep, maybe you are thinking about them, dreaming about the loss that you went through. And then we have the emotional experience of depression, which is now the feelings of regret, the feelings of guilt, the shame that you might feel, the feeling stuck, hopelessness, and helplessness. I have encountered people who lost a loved one and they begin to wish that they could go and be with them, because this loss, this emptiness, this space that they left, nobody can feel it, nothing can feel it, and the experience is excruciatingly painful, and they want to escape. When you get into that depressed state, what you can do, number one, is to be able to process what your mind is telling you about the loss. This is so important, because a lot of the things that we experience in life, they have a lot to do with the mind. The narrative that we attach to the loss now is going to trigger depression and anxiety. Journaling is so helpful. A lot of times people ask, how do I journal? Because when I start, I just talk about the negative. What you want to do with the loss of a loved one, and you have gotten yourself into that state of depression and you can't get yourself out of that, I always say that you can do a letter, which is almost like a sandwich. So you start with celebrating what their life was like, and then you go the second paragraph, you're talking about how you are feeling about the loss, the emptiness, the sadness, the questions, the fears of the future. You identify that, and then the last paragraph, you now write about what you would like to see happen moving forward. How do I live with this loss? So don't just stay in, this is what I have lost, this is how confused I am. But then you want to ask yourself, as you go through that, how am I going to survive without you? Answer that question for real and begin to look at, which are the areas in my life that I feel I am not going to be able to be successful without the departed person, and begin to come up with plans on how you are going to survive this loss, how you are going to survive without them. That really helps to move you away from the depressive state. Seek the help of a grief counselor so that they can help you to move along the grief process in a healthy way. Once you have gone through the stage of depression, we actually enter into acceptance, because we get into the space where now, and the reason why the grief is so deep during the depression stage is because we are moving away from denial, bargaining, and anger to acceptance. To accepting that it has happened, accepting that this relationship is done and I will never be able to get it back, this person is gone forever. That acceptance is where now you begin the next process, which is what I call the tasks of the grieving. And the tasks of the grieving are two. Number one, to adjust to the new normal. So how do you adjust to the new normal? After you have accepted this person is gone, then I begin to create my life intentionally with the belief, the conviction, the knowledge, the consciousness that now I'm alone. There will be the process of feeling the loneliness, the unfairness of the situation, and the helplessness, but there is also the resilience that I am allowing myself to experience, even if it's in small doses, and being able to actually see that there are some things that I am still, even as I'm feeling these intense feelings, there are some things that I am doing right now to be in charge of my life, even though I feel out of charge, I feel out of control. But there are things that I'm able to do. What you want to do in this adjustment period as you move through the process of grief is to actually be more conscious about how you are living your life with the loss of the person. Because sometimes we feel like we are not going to survive, but in reality we are surviving because we are waking up every day, we are going to work, we are taking care of the kids. There are so many things we are doing right. But the experience, the emotional experience, feels like we are stuck. And so that is what I normally actually help my clients to see, that in this process, as you go on, you are actually living your life, even though it feels like you are stuck. Then the advancement. The advancement is where you are advancing into this life where you experience, you are hoping to experience your full life, even with the loss that you have been accorded with. So you might feel guilty or disloyal if you are happy in your life. Whenever there is a moment or an opportunity to be happy, to be successful, you feel like you are being disloyal to your loved one because it's you are moving on with life. And so it is important to also work with a therapist, because the therapist will help you get into your psyche. And so in order for us to move through this pain of loss, then we have to get back into our psyche and explore and process the narratives that we are forming and we have formed about the loss. When we do that, we are able to kind of move through the grief process in a healthy way. When you are going through the grief process, it's very confusing because the grief process is not seamless, it's not fluid. It's usually you might feel all the five stages in one day, because you are triggered here and there. But it is important for you to be able to understand the stages so that when your mood changes, when you suddenly are starting to cry, you are telling yourself, I am crying because I had a memory. There was a smell. There was something somebody said that triggered my loss. And this is what I felt. I didn't go to anger. I went into deep feelings of sadness, deep feelings of loneliness. And so during that hour, I was in that depressive state. And then you can say 2 hours later, I had actually gone back to acceptance and I was feeling much better. And this is what happened that caused me to feel better than I was feeling 2 hours ago. So that process of identifying where you are in the grief process every day as you experience the emotion you experience is very empowering, because now you don't feel like there is something outside of yourself that you can't control that is happening to you. Now you know that these are emotions that are common to a lot of people, and it is a grief process, and these are the things that I can do. These are the tips that I can use to better cope when I go through these triggers and when the loss is experienced in intense ways. Grief is very personal. And so it's important for you to be in touch with your feelings and to accept them as yours. And then it is important for you to see the resources that you have within you that help you to walk through the grief. Because sometimes we can find that we are confused about why we are feeling what we are feeling, and we wish to know whether it is normal. And that in itself will create dissonance in your mind, confusion in your mind, and the grief will be, the experience of that loss will be much more intense. And so educational videos like this one helps you to normalize what you are going through and to understand that within that space of grieving, it is normal to have this kind of emotions during the day, at night, and in other times. It is important for you to seek for help when you need to. So don't postpone the help. If your gut is telling you are not okay, get help. Now, how do you know that? When you begin to experience intense feelings of anxiety, the fear of unknown, the restlessness, the crying a lot, the isolating, the feeling that you don't want to go to work, you don't want to be bothered by your children, you don't want to go to be anywhere near people. When you begin to realize that you are irritable, And these situations are like the normal situations of sitting down with kids and helping them with homework, but you are snapping. It feels like you don't care. You are not engaging. At that point, you do need to seek for help so that you can get the help before things get to be bad. Mental health issues, which grief and loss are mental health issues, they don't get better with time. They get worse if they are not addressed and dealt with. Reach out to me. I'll be glad to even do an evaluation of where you are with the grief process, even as you have listened to me throughout these four videos, and see we can be able to do an assessment to see where you are and help you to be able to move through that grief process in a healthy way. Until I see you next time, I wish you God's blessings and continue to live by design.